Bob Halstead and Danny Chinoff, who are both Nevadans here today. And as we started setting up the panel, we wanted to do something a little different this year, just since the conference is in Nevada and Yucca Mountain is, you know, it's not just a national issue, it's also a Nevada issue. We wanted to have a discussion of parties from within Nevada. And one of the things that reminded me of is several years ago, when I was in the Department of Energy working on the Yucca Mountain Project, we were invited to go to Wisconsin to testify before a joint legislative session where they were considering lifting the moratorium on nuclear new building. And so I went representing the pro-Yucca DOE position, and Steve Frischman went representing the Nevada anti-Yucca position. And with me, I took as a staffer a young woman who was a management intern at DOE who had graduated from the University of Wisconsin-Madison. And so she was relatively new to issues, and we go up and, you know, I did my thing in the morning. Steve Frischman did his thing in the morning. They took a break for lunch. We walked outside, and I looked at Steve Frischman. He was accompanied by Junior Tricol. Said, y'all want to go grab some lunch? So, yeah. Well, we went and we had lunch. We talked about fly fishing and needlepoint, because I have a daughter that does needlepoint. Judy is into needlepoint. And we had about an hour of just decent, civil discussion about everything that Yucca Mountain or politics. And we're walking back to the Capitol building, and Robin Sampson, now Robin Wall, she said, I think I'm in the twilight zone. I said, what are you talking about? She goes, they're our enemies. I'm like, no, they're not our enemies. She goes, you like know them, and they know you. I said, yeah. She goes, well, how can you go and have lunch and have such a pleasant conversation with them when you're so far apart on this issue? I said, well, being far apart on issues is not a reason to hate somebody. I said, you know, my wife and I don't agree on everything, but we still love each other. And so I just tell that story, hopefully to set the tone for this morning, which is what I expect to be the civil discourse. And so we have two Nevadans this morning that I've known for a number of years, have a lot of respect for Bob Halstead. And Bob is one of those people I genuinely respect. I don't question his integrity at all. And he and I are as far apart on this issue, in most cases, not in all cases, as we could be. And Dan Chinoff, he and I probably share most of the same positions on this issue, although not all of them. But I know both of these men to be men of high character and honor and utmost integrity. And so I think we'll hear a couple of different positions on Yucca Mountain Restart this morning. We're going to start with Bob Halstead, who is executive director of the Agency for Nuclear Projects for the state of Nevada. He basically leads for the governor and the attorney general, you know, the Nevada efforts involved in the Yucca Mountain licensing proceeding. And he's worked for the state of Nevada since 1988, so he's been around this issue for a long time. He's authored more than 40 different publications on energy policy and impact assessment. And he's advised the state of Wisconsin, the National Governors Association, on legislation that resulted in the Employees Policy Act of 1982 and the Amendments Act, excuse me, of 1987. So Bob's going to go first, and then I'll introduce Dan, and he'll go, and then hopefully we can have a dialogue and discussion with the audience this morning. And please feel free to text me questions, and I'll get them up here, and we can address them. Bob, you can do whatever.
I think that's what I want to do. Well, good morning, everyone. Here in Nevada, we do have some extreme weather events, but we don't have anything like what's happened in the last 2 weeks. It might happen, unfortunately, this weekend. So I'd just like to ask everyone to take a minute and think about those natural disasters. And those of you who pray, please mention in your prayers our fellow citizens who've been affected by Hurricane Harvey. And those who are in the path of Hurricane Irma, which might be an equally dangerous storm. And please, everyone who can afford to contribute, think about making a contribution to the funds that we use to take care of, to the extent that can be done. I know people want to give clothes and everything, but you know, in a situation like this, Red Cross and other organizations need money. Now, this morning I'm going to do something a little different than I usually do. I'm going to actually talk from a prepared text. I'm not going to read the slides. I want to try to get through a lot of complicated material, 18 slides, and try to do it in about 13 or 14 minutes so we have more time for questions. So if I seem rude because I'm working at a fast pace, and I'm not going to entertain any questions in the middle of anything, so please bear with me. Most people who don't get paid to think about Yucca Mountain probably haven't thought much about the details for the last 6 years. And it looks like the situation has occurred now where we're going to be doing that. So let's see, where is my, is this my advance button? Website, we're going to improve it, but all the documents, including all the documents from the licensing proceeding, which is many thousands of pages are there. All right, I'm going to start with my conclusions, and my conclusions about what should be done to fix the nuclear waste program really are affected by the Blue Ribbon Commission on America's Nuclear Future recommendations in 2012, which the state has endorsed. And in our view, the key recommendations are taking the program out of the Department of Energy and adopting a consent-based approach to siting both storage and disposal facilities. And these changes, in our opinion, cannot be successfully implemented unless Congress and the Department of Energy are prepared to walk away from Yucca Mountain. Now, what does exist at Yucca Mountain, if you read some of the editorials coming out of local newspapers in South Carolina and Washington, my gosh, there's a repository there waiting to be used, and the Obama administration shut it down. Well, that is unfortunately a debate that needs to be straightened out. The facts on the ground are there's a 5-mile exploratory tunnel which can be worked into the repository design, but cannot by itself be used for waste storage or disposal. Indeed, Congress hasn't appropriated any money for DOE activities at Yucca Mountain since fiscal year 2011. Now, to make the statement short, the political opposition to Yucca Mountain in Nevada has never been stronger. The public opinion opposition is about the same. We did a lot of polling between the years 2000 and 2010. We haven't done polling since then. But we have a situation where the governor of the state, in his State of the State speech, took a very strong position and said he was pledging relentless opposition and maximum resources. That's Governor Brian Sandoval. Attorney General Adam Paul Laxalt and all of the top elected statewide leaders, Republicans and Democrats in Nevada, are strongly opposed to Yucca Mountain. And the majority of Nevadans polled are not only against Yucca Mountain, but when you add a measure of intensity, you find that 51% of the poll respondents are strongly opposed and 23% are strongly in favor. Okay, just to go over a few facts. Most people in this room know that most of the spent fuel is at commercial reactors in the east, stored on site. The NRC has determined in 2015 that spent nuclear fuel can be stored safely on site for up to 160 years. Most of us in the business know that spent fuel is legally radioactive, but that the radiological hazard declines by 2/3 after 50 years due to the decay of the strontium-90 and the cesium-137, particularly the cesium-137. Shipping older fuel first, as recommended by the National Academy of Sciences, is a good, straightforward way to reduce transportation radiological impacts, and hopefully that reduces the social impacts as well. Now, under the 1982 Nuclear Waste Policy Act, which as Eric said, I was one of the group of people who worked with the National Governors Association Task Force on that legislation. DOE identified 9 potential sites in 6 states for the first repository, and for the second repository, 12 potentially acceptable sites and 10 backup sites in 17 eastern and midwestern states. You see them on the map here. The 1987 Nuclear Waste Policy Amendments Act deferred work on the second repository and terminated all the first round site work except for the underground site in Nevada. Now, DOE had selected Nevada, Texas, and Washington as, let's see if this is better, as finalists for the first repository. But then when Congress changed the law, Texas was protected by Jim Wright, the Speaker of the House. State of Washington was protected by Tom Foley, the House Majority Leader, and the next Speaker of the House. And that's why we call it the Screw Nevada Act, and that's why we say it was picked based on political science and not earth science. Now, fast forward to 2008, when DOE submitted the license application and final supplemental environmental impact statement to the NRC. And this is a slide that's probably hard to read, but it summarizes all of the details in the DOE, LA, and the EIS. And in the LA, the license application is for a repository that is restricted per statute to 70,000 metric tons of uranium, or metric tons heavy metal, if you will, 90% commercial and 10% defense in that first repository. But DOE also, and I need to get a drink of water, pardon me. In that EIS, DOE also provided an analysis of how Yucca Mountain might be expanded to 130,000 MTUs and 36,000 canisters of solidified defense waste. They also looked at possibly disposing of greater than class C waste as well. And so in this slide, I just try to summarize. I'm not going to go through all the numbers, but the most important thing looking at the overall total system performance assessment is the DOE is planning to place a titanium drip shield over each of the waste packages, and all of the package and drip shield replacement work would have to be done remotely and robotically because of the intense radiation in the drifts, because the package surface dose rates would be over 1,000 grams per hour. And it'd be very hot in there, even with forced ventilation, it would be 120 to 140 degrees Fahrenheit or 50 to 60 degrees C. And in 2008, DOE estimated that the whole package going forward, the Yucca Mountain, would cost about $97 million, including about $15 million already spent. This is all put in constant value dollars, 2008 dollars. So the NRC licensing proceeding was suspended for lack of funds in 2011, restarted by court order in 2013 using carryover funds, and DOE decided not to participate. That's why the NRC staff, for example, ended up doing the EIS supplemental groundwater impacts. Now, we don't know at this date, this late date in September, what's going to happen with the appropriations process for the fiscal year that starts October 1, but we do know the Trump administration has requested $150 million for FY 2018, $120 million for DOE, and $30 million for the NRC. If the full licensing proceeding were to resume, and all of Nevada's assumptions have been based on the assumption that it will resume, we plan to adjudicate all of the 218 admitted contentions in opposition to DOE's license application. Those were admitted by the licensing board in 2009. We plan to submit an additional 30 to 50 new contentions. We think the full legally mandated proceeding, if it goes forward, would take 5 years and cost $2 billion. Now, the illustrations I'm going to use here are DOE's illustrations from the EIS and from their cost study in 2008. We believe the Yucca Mountain is an unsuitable site for a geologic repository because of its complex geology and hydrology. The original citing guidelines came out on my birthday, 1983. And a lot of our critique of Yucca Mountain really began before I worked for Nevada, based on the fact that the site that was eventually selected in 87, we believe, did not fit those original guidelines. The fractured rock above and below the repository horizon will allow corrosive oxidizing groundwater to transport radioactive material from the waste packages into the water table that flows into Amargosa Valley. This, of course, is going to be a big point of contention for licensing. And our contentions challenge the DOE's proposition that engineered barriers could overcome these deficiencies in geology and hydrology. And here on the right side of the slide, those little blue mailbox-looking things, those are the titanium drip shields that DOE proposes to install robotically, between 11,000 and 26,000 of them, one over each waste package. They're 19 feet long. They weigh more than 5 tons each. And that installation would begin over a century from now at a cost of about $7.8 billion, DOE estimates. And the unresolved questions are, will the NRC be around and actually require that installation? Will Congress pay for them? Can they be fabricated and installed as DOE proposes? And then even if they're installed properly, will they actually work? DOE plans to supplement the titanium drip shields by keeping the temperature within the emplacement drifts above the boiling point of water for about 1,000 years, in what DOE calls the mid-pillar regions between the drifts would be kept at a lower temperature, below 96 degrees C. And in theory, this would create thermal pathways in those mid-pillar regions that would keep infiltrating water away from the waste packages. And Nevada contends that this will actually complicate the situation more, because the infiltrating water would become even more corrosively aggressive because of water rock reactions that occur in that high temperature environment. We're also preparing new contentions, that challenge DOE's previous assessment of groundwater impacts based on the NRC staff's EIS supplement and on the safety evaluation report. And in particular, we're concerned that neither DOE nor NRC have properly addressed impacts on the Tibbush Shoshone tribe and on Native American cultural resources. And the key issue, as I said, in the licensing proceeding is going to be whether or not the repository can prevent radioactive contamination of groundwater for 1 million years as required. The EPA and NRC regulations limit individual radiation doses resulting from groundwater contamination to 15 millirem for the first 10,000 years and 100 millirem per year for the next 990,000 years. The NRC staff calculates that only a small amount of contamination, or resulting in doses of 1.3 millirem per year, would occur during the first 200,000 years. And Nevada's contentions argue that the 10,000-year standard could be exceeded in less than 900 years, and the million-year standard could be exceeded in less than 2,000 years. It's also important to remember that Nevada is challenging that two-part radiation protection standard in federal court. Turning to transportation, Nevada's contentions challenge DOE's assertion that 95% of the inventory can be delivered by rail, challenge DOE's plan to use overweight trucks for cross-country shipments by highway, challenge DOE's assessment impacts along the route, and then challenge the consequence assessments, where even though DOE acknowledges that cleaning up after a severe accident or sabotage incident resulting in release of radioactive materials could cost up to $10 billion, we believe they still underestimated those impacts. And these contentions underscore DOE's failure to incorporate and implement the 2006 recommendations of the National Academy of Sciences report, which was later adopted by the Blue Ribbon Commission. And just, I'm going to deviate for just a couple seconds and say, I've been deeply involved in the debate over transportation risk assessment and impact management for more than three decades now. And the National Academy of Sciences adopted 95% of Nevada's recommendations. And for us, that's the template for resolving the public concern over the risks of these shipments, if they should occur in Nevada or if they go somewhere else. Unfortunately, we find that there has been little support in the last 11 years now for the actual implementation of those recommendations. Now, in addition to these more general transportation impacts, 48% and as much as 85% of DOE shipments would directly impact Las Vegas. And we have a couple of contentions that specifically challenge the unique local conditions assessment in the environmental impact statement. And in particular, rail access is a big issue because of the need to move large packages, whether it's something like the DOE MPC or the dual purpose canisters most utilities are using. And our contentions challenge the feasibility and impacts of DOE's plan for constructing and operating the Caliente rail line. And we believe DOE's plan for this 300-mile railroad costing between $2 and $3 billion underestimates the challenges of the rugged mountainous terrain, particularly going east-west across seven north-south mountain ranges, surface flood hazards, and land use conflicts, not the least of which is in Garden Valley, where sculptor Michael Heiser has constructed a very large, possibly the largest outdoor sculpture installation in the world. And Nevada is going to challenge any DOE efforts to revive their land withdrawal for the rail corridor, which has expired. Any new applications for state water permits, they need over 100, they withdrew those. And any future effort to obtain a certificate of public convenience and necessity from the U.S. Surface Transportation Board, which they need because they're planning this as a common carrier railroad. So I like the fact that my last slide is pretty much the same as Wayne Norton's last slide at the end of yesterday. One positive thing that could be done politically in Washington is to either pass the nuclear waste informed consent legislation introduced by Nevada's delegation, with the exception of Congressman Amaday, as a standalone bill. But it's also designed to be added as an amendment, either to an appropriations bill or to an authorizing bill. And I think I'm going to leave it at that. Anyone who has questions about Chairman Shimkus's bill, H.R. 3053, or the legislative action that we expect in the Senate coming from Senator Lukowski and others, I'd be happy to talk about that and questions. Thank you.
And we welcome it. It's a multi-generational, multi-billion dollar project. If it's not proven to be safe, what are you going to do? Are we going to start over and wait another 50 years and leave it sit by lakes, rivers, and oceans? So I'm new to this. I feel always strained in this thing because I'm just a stupid elected official. You guys are nuclear scientists and geologists. How many PhDs or high degrees are out here? Come on, let me see. Yeah. So I really come from a point of view of having to ask people when I first moved to Pine County. I went to the repository office and I got all the books and I read them, and then I started talking to guys who actually worked out there, and now they've been at these conferences for a number of years. And when we first started coming, no one wanted to talk to us. And now I get to come up and talk to y'all. How does this thing work? There we go. Nuclear science over political science. I'm glad Bob kind of brought that up in the 1987 Screw Nevada bill, because that's in my presentation too. But that's, I think, the crux of the matter of where we're at now. You know, we're letting politics rule the day, run the show. Good thing everybody was behind Voyager. Otherwise, it would still be on the launch pad. View atop Yucca Mountain. Located on some of the most secure land in the world. The mountain ridge comprised layers of volcanic rock, one of the most studied geological formations in the world. So where are we today? That's what I was under the impression we were talking about today. We were going to talk about where are we at. Well, Reid Obama defunded and proclaimed the project dead. The Nuclear Waste Project Act still remains the law of the land, while the Blue Ribbon Commission had recommendations and actually didn't deal with the other one. So we had recommendations, that's nice, but we have a law. And that is really what our board, and by the way, we're not alone. Nine, including us, nine of 17 counties have asked to have the site surveyed. President Trump's budget provides $120 million to restart licensing. House appropriations approved funding for Yucca Mountain in the DOE budget. The House has continually approved funding for Yucca Mountain on large bipartisan numbers. It's not a Republican issue. It's not a Democrat issue. It's a national security issue. And I think we need to start seeing that and hearing that more in presentations and from our elected officials in the federal government and our state government. This is national security. Senate appropriations withheld funding and instead funded interim. NRC voted in August to proceed with information gathering. The information gathering, we sent our letter in, the state sent their letter in on the information gathering. The state typically was very negative and said all the things that just can't get all this information together. It's going to take all this time and money. And my staff informed me that we have all that. We have our records from the last gathering of the information. We're happy to provide it to the state or anybody else who needs it. So it's not that big of a lift, but it needs to move forward. So why is the state fighting against hearing the science? The Nuclear Waste Policy Act is still the governing law, and it requires DOE to move forward with a license application for Yucca Mountain. DOE believes the license application shows that Yucca Mountain is a good site. It is NRC's job to independently assess, and if so, grant the necessary license. So my presentation will be a lot quicker, I'm sure. We'll get to the questions in a moment. So is Nevada against Yucca Mountain? Well, when you read the papers and hear most of the news things, Nevada's against it. Most of our federal litigation, nobody in Nevada wants it. So nine rural counties have resolutions to hear the science. Nye, Esmeralda, Mineral, Churchill, Lander, Elko, Humboldt, White Pine, and Lincoln. The rural counties will most be affected, actually. Las Vegas Review Journal poll. I love polls, depending on what you ask and how you say it. Do you want your children irradiated? Well, no, we don't want our children irradiated. Do you want a multi-billion dollar, multi-generational project that will improve infrastructure? Well, yeah, we might want that. So polls are funny, because the poll that we refer to was March 2015. 55% of Nevadans are open to having a discussion about Yucca Mountain. 53% of Clark County residents polled felt the same way. Actually, most people in the state don't even think about this. When you ask them their priorities, their top 10 priorities, I think you wouldn't really find Yucca Mountain even in the top 10. If it's there, it's probably way down. I have to correct this a bit. Senator Pico Cachia represents Nye County. Supports a plan for Yucca Mountain that would include interim storage. Actually, Pete hasn't actually said he's in favor of Yucca Mountain. He does say, we have an area there, why don't we at least sign up for interim? And he is interested in talking about a potential recycling program, as is Mark Emmett. And Mark and I have had many conversations on this. Federal lawmaker representing Nevada working to get the best deal for the state through Yucca Mountain, which could bring nuclear research reprocessing to the site. What Mark says about Yucca Mountain is, we don't want a nuclear dump, but let's talk about reprocessing and recycling. And Nye County doesn't want another dump. We host two already. We have Area 5, which is a lot closer to Las Vegas and Yucca Mountain. We also have an abandoned dump just outside of Beatty. And in Area 5, I don't know if we did this, we already store U-233-35, which is as hot as anything will go in the Yucca Mountain, above the water table in a 40-foot trench. And the state gave me okay for that. Thought it was safe. But somehow under 1,000 feet of rock, 700 feet above the water table, in cast, inside a cast, that's not safe. I'm confused. Again, I'm not a nuclear scientist. I don't know. So let me go on. State Assemblyman Chris Edwards opposed a recent anti-Yucca resolution stating the state has a multi-billion dollar asset sitting idle. You can see it as the glass half full or the glass half empty. I'm a positive guy, so. No one from my county is on the Nevada Commission on Nuclear Projects. Let me fix that. On the Nevada Commission Against Nuclear Projects. Even though the Nevada Association of Counties have nominated me twice, and we actually did have one of our former commissioners appointed. I think it was 06 or 07. She was appointed, and 2 weeks later they asked her to resign because she wasn't against the project. She had our county stance, which is follow the law. Let's hear the science. Safety. I better change these slides. I'm reading stuff without changing slides. I told you I'm not good at this. All evidence vetted today shows Yucca Mountain can be done safely. By submitting its license application, the Department of Energy has concluded that it's safe. The United States National Laboratories have concluded it is safe. The Independent Nuclear Regulatory Commission technical staff have concluded that it is safe. It only makes sense to make any decision about how to proceed based on hearing whether the state's arguments have merit. Nevada's safety arguments need to be vetted. Note, however, that they have not been shown to be conclusive as claimed by state officials and reported in the Nevada press. And that one I find very interesting. All the press seems to say is Dan Shinhoven is the sole voice in favor of Yucca Mountain. 9 of 17 counties. 58%, 55% in the one poll. Come on, there we go. Fear-mongering versus engagement. Why oppose the licensing process? This is where you get to prove your point. If it's not safe, this is where you get to do it. By engaging now in Nevada, any affected counties have an opportunity to ensure safety of the residents most impacted by the repository. Why is the state afraid to move forward with vetting its contentions? The state appears to currently be in a position of leverage with Yucca Mountain. We have the chance, we have a window to get a lot of things that we want to see happen. They should use that position to build the state's infrastructure, sparking a new era of economic growth. It would improve the state's education system and new research opportunities to the state's colleges and universities. It would bring high-paying technical jobs back to the state that were lost when Reid Obama unfunded the project, 2,500 jobs were lost back then. That really hurt my county. And it hurt Southern Nevada, not just my county. And it would provide thousands of union construction jobs. Doing nothing is not an option. This is my last slide for those of you who've been waiting. Nuclear waste continues to sit around the country, posing a national security concern. 500 million United States tax dollars are being spent each year because the federal government has not moved forward with Yucca Mountain, even though 35 billion is in the nuclear waste fund, which by law cannot be used for anything other than to complete Yucca Mountain licensing and operation. Nevada should be able to capitalize on helping eliminate the current and future penalty payments for the utilities. The federal government currently is not getting about $750 million a year from the utility companies. And then my last point, and then we get to questions. I love questions. And I wish I could blow that up. I don't know how to do this, but the state, I couldn't find anywhere where the governor says he is in favor or that he believes in global warming, that he thinks the science is in on global warming. What I did find is on every state website, references global warming. I'm not here to debate global warming. I'm not going to say it's not real either. But $12 billion has been spent studying Yucca Mountain, a a sliver of land. $50 billion spent on climate research. The governor says he won't, the quote I did get, is he wouldn't say, you know, he believes in the science on global warming or disbelieves it, because he said he's not an atmospheric scientist or a climatologist. But he continues to say the science in Yucca Mountain is bad, and I don't think he's a nuclear scientist. And I'm not either, and neither is my board. We just want the law to be followed and have that body impaneled by our federal government that deals with nuclear issues to hear the science. The way past Yucca Mountain is for the state to stop relentlessly opposing every jot and tittle, and let's get on with hearing the contentions. We welcome the contentions. They want to add 30, 50, 100 more. All my grandchildren live in Yucca, in Nye County, in Pahrump. All my children own homes there. I want to be assured, and the best way to be assured is to get all the contentions out, have the hearings, and then when you finally get past Yucca Mountain, doing nothing is not an option, and it's way past time to stop relying on political science over nuclear science. Thank you, and I welcome questions when the moderator says it.
Speakers, appreciate your presentations, and also some reminder, you can text questions, and they are coming through. It looks like they're anonymous at this point, but I guess you can put your name on if you want to, but in the meantime, are there any questions from the audience? Well, it's hard to see the audience so well. Oh, there's one back there. Please identify yourself and then ask your question.
Chip Cameron, and thank you both for those presentations. Bob, the NRC safety evaluation report was issued after the suspension of the licensing proceeding, and I know that there are many of your contentions that are still relevant to the safety evaluation report, but I was just curious. Did the safety evaluation report that the NRC did that alleviate any of your concerns, or did it add to any of your concerns?
Well, first of all, I need to remember that once the license is accepted, the NRC staff becomes an advocate for the license. The licensing boards are independent. The commission is made up of politically appointed people approved by the Senate. So, as the proceeding goes forward, the safety evaluation report is part of the NRC staff's case. They are, in effect, one of, can't keep all the numbers straight because of consolidation. I think there are actually 18 parties that have some degree of status in the proceeding. The safety evaluation report is not supposed to respond to contentions. The safety evaluation report is the staff's finding that they believe that DOE has complied with the requirements in 10 CFR Part 63. You'll note that they concluded that DOE had not met the requirements for land control and water rights. So, as it goes forward, both the SER, which is 5 volumes, a couple thousand pages, and the staff's EIS supplement on groundwater impacts, they become part of the proceeding. The NRC staff, pardon me, we worked on them, they witness depositions, and they testify and cross-examine. So there's a lot of interesting information in the SER, some of which we challenged, some of which we accepted. The SER is not really intended to resolve the contentions. That puts us basically, we're about 50% of the way through the legally mandated licensing proceeding, in spite of the delays that occurred. So we have all the preliminary tasks are complete. completed. And the SER is one of those preliminary tasks.
Thank you. I have a quick question too. For this question for both speakers. The Congress hasn't provided any appropriations or funding for Yucca Mountain since I think 2010. And as part of the Nuclear Waste Policy Act, the state and the affected units of local government have over the years received about $500 million in funding. And we know that funding for the Department of Energy and for the Nuclear Regulatory Commission is a serious concern right now. How are you guys funding your efforts with no funding from the federal government?
Well, the state actually had some carryover money. And I think at last count, we probably had about $200,000 left. We've really, you know, like squirrel with nuts, those have been kept aside. But the state legislature has really shown support for this and for the coming 2 years. $3.6 million, about $1.9 million a year for the agency that I manage, and $1.7 million a year for the Attorney General's office. That will not obviously be enough money if the money that was requested for the in the Trump administration budget goes through. In that budget, I mean, and none of the affected local governments have gotten funding for the effective Indian tribe, but I think there's a total of about, what, $9 or $10 million in money for the state and the locals?
Yeah, almost $3 million directly to us. But if I could, Mr. Halstead, I think you left off the $7 million that you guys approved for your lawyers. You have $7 million for lawyers. That was up this past year. And so the state, with their relentless opposition, I guess will continue to fund it. The figures I have is they spent $50 million of Nevada taxpayer money fighting it since 2002. My county, we don't have any money, but the one guy we got left, we put in planning water districts, just so we can keep somebody around and do the science and maybe we could help correct this. So yeah, the funding is critical for us to be able to contend. And more than that, it's critical for the full faith and trust of the United States government to follow through on their law. It was defunded in 2010, and we joined the lawsuit that said you gotta release the SERs, and then they did that. We got the SERs out, and then there was the supplemental EIS, and then there was a supplement to the supplement because the former administration had a little money left, so they did a supplement to a supplement. But the funds now that are being considered, I think absolutely have to be put out there. I mean, if we're still a nation of laws, let's follow the law. I mean, let's hear the science.
Can I just correct your number?
Go ahead, please.
We don't have quite that much money. So you're right, it's about $50 million that's been spent since 2002, and about half of that was federal funds, half of the state. And the $7 million, that was an authorization to spend what comes through, so that defends it. But right now the budget we're working on is $7.2 million over 2 years, beginning July 1st.
And I think, Darrell, our budget's about $7.20.
Thank you.
Sure.
My name is Gary Duart. I'm director of the U.S. Nuclear Energy Foundation here in Nevada. It's a 501c3, and we're pro Yucca Mountain construction. I'd like to mention a couple of things. The industry, you cannot remain politically correct on an issue that is politically created. That's exactly what this is. I heard someone mention during the presentation a little bit about a referendum. Our organization has asked the governor and several political operatives in the state of Nevada to bring Yucca Mountain to a public referendum. There has never been any response from that, and we can only assume it's because they don't dare to make it a public referendum to the people and the citizens of the state itself. My concern is that politics has been able to control the media in Nevada, and I do know that there are millions of Nevadans that need to be educated. It is critically important that this issue be moved into grassroots education. And I'm asking Mr. Halstead, do you really think that the citizens of Nevada are represented by the politics and the press of this state?
Well, Ed, the polling that really counts in the end is what happens on election day, Gary. And,
you mean in 2016?
Solid group of 20 to 25% of the people that answer polls in Nevada that strongly support Yucca now. And then there's a majority of people who oppose it. And I think if you look at the vote in the legislature, you see pretty much a reflection of that kind of breakdown. I say about referendums, you know, we have an open system in Nevada. Anybody can seek a referendum. I personally don't recommend it because I've studied, and you know, we've had 5 statewide nuclear referendums in the U.S., and none of them have shown any great support for nuclear waste disposal, even in pro-nuclear states like North Carolina and the state of Washington, where the vote, once it went to the ballot, was 80% against, and that was the same thing in Wisconsin, which was maybe less pro-nuclear. So on the political side of it, I think that we acknowledge that there are people in the state that are intensely pro-Yucca Mountain and have been for a long time. What's really interesting is when you look at the polling data, even when we were in the midst of a bad recession here, when you might have thought that more people would be seeking it for economic reasons, there really wasn't more than a couple of percentage points change. So it's been pretty solid.
Can I chime in on that?
Sure.
Discounting the one poll from 2015, I guess those figures are correct, but I think if you have a referendum like that, somebody needs to inform the general public. And polling has to be. Again, I mean, do I want my children irradiated? Well, no, I'm asking people would say no. So depending on how you ask questions, so being informed is very important, and what Mr. Halstead and the state are pushing for the Informed Consent Act, we're first part of that is informed, and we're at that point. We can be informed if the state would not continue to block the way to have the hearing. We could have informed. And then make an informed decision on the matter. But if, depending on how you phrase it, yeah, you know, do you want to cover the moon with cream cheese? And if you say that right, you probably get 51% of the people to say yes. So.
See, I just say like referendums. The one thing, I've got a lot of thinking about this, Gary, and I think if you're in a consent-based situation, whether it's for a repository or an interim storage facility, get to the end point, you know, after a license has been granted and safety issues are resolved, and then it's a matter of deciding whether it's a repository or an interim storage or whether it's Nevada or some other place. I think you might be able to make a case for a referendum on accepting the final terms of a consent agreement. I just think you get to the point where you're going to make every decision by referendum. I think you probably get to have one good referendum. When would you have it, at the beginning or the end? But that's the thinking I've done.
And I've heard over the years a lot of discussion about referendums. We should just put this to the public and let them vote on. And the question I have is at what point? I mean, there's a sequence. There's a natural, logical progression and sequence to things. And we're at a point right now where I don't honestly think that the whole story is out there. That's what the Nuclear Regulatory Commission process is about. You know, the government has made their case in their license application. They get to defend that case in the next phase of the license process, the public adjudication phase. The state has their case, and they get to defend their position in that, and make their case more publicly in the public adjudication phase of the NRC licensing process. And for technical issues, we have technical experts that need to weigh in, and that's the staff and the NRC commission. That's what the law says. That's the process that works in nuclear power plants and other nuclear facilities that get NRC licenses and are regulated. You know, I think it's a slippery slope to start saying, well, the public, who, and I'm not going to say the uninformed public, but at this point, nobody has all the information out there. I mean, for example, a lot is known about the $10 to $12 billion of U.S. you know, government science and research done on Yucca Mountain. You know, the state has their science and their researchers. I'm anxious to know what that is. And that gets to one of the questions that came in. The question is, why is the state fighting an opportunity to air out the science on Yucca Mountain and get to the truth? And so that's the essence of the statement I just made, and it's a question. You know, I don't think we have enough information to put it to a referendum yet. Maybe we do. Maybe it's just the flavor of it that people don't like. But, you know, so, Bob, what is the state's position on opposing the opportunity to actually, if you're confident in your science, I guess is another way to say it, then why do you want to get it out there and tell the story?
Well, there are two separate issues here. That's a fair way to ask the question, Aaron. There is deep distrust on the part of older Nevadans and certainly the political leadership of government nuclear science, going back to the AEC days, going back to the 87 Act, and indeed going back to the fact that even Shipkus's committee was willing to endorse consent-based siting for everybody and everything except Yucca Mountain in Nevada. So there is a real deep wound over the politics of 1987. I must say, I was part of that process. And it's not as simple as it's sometimes displayed as Screw Nevada. There were, frankly, we didn't know the things about Yucca Mountain that we know about now. I don't think Yucca Mountain would ever have been picked out if we'd known, for example, about the infiltration issue and some of the technical issues. But be that as it may, there is, on the one hand, a deep political concern. This has been the reason that the state has imposed the licensing proceeding going forward, is why do we want to participate in something that we believe is unfair? Now, on the other side, if it goes forward, we're probably the best prepared party to do this. I mean, we've been meeting with our technical and legal team by phone pretty much three times a month since, and I think that would be addressed. But again, this does say that the governor is signing for the state. I assume your commission would speak for Nye County. But that is our concept of no referendums or attorney general opinions. This is, for example, in New Mexico, part of the way the WIP process worked. But that is the way that we conceive of it.
If we do everything on a referendum, we become a democracy. We're a republic. Yeah, we've elected us people to make these decisions, and we need to move forward. But on consent, I think it was the last slide. And I find it, I don't know how else to say it, I'm not trying to be rude, but it seems a bit disingenuous to say you want consent from every county and every municipality that this stuff can pass. Well,
no, that's not right. No, that's not the way to go.
Oh, okay, well,
that's this is in Nevada.
Okay, yes. Well, 9 of 17 counties are good, and I think we could get Clark County to be avoided while the state still has. But on consent, you know, the DOE had the recommendations and for years couldn't figure out what consent was, and then they did a tour around and they tried to figure out what consent means. And consent, I just don't see how it works when you've got that big of a pool because I've run twice, and I'm personally in favor of Yucca Mountain, and I've won big in my county both times. Now, the next guy to run against the governor, maybe he'll run for governor, maybe he'll say, look, let's move forward, and if it's safe, we'll get it. But how do you get the consent? The state didn't have a chance to agree or disagree in 2002, as provided for in the law and in the veto. And we see how consent works. The Basin and Range Monument, Lincoln and Nye County, and as we've all said, please, we don't want it. It was given to us. The U-233-35 that went into Area 5, both county again, we were excluded from those discussions. So, I mean, there's and as far as deep wounds, I get that there are people who are holding on to that, but we're putting national security at risk for this. And let's get to the science, let's get to the area.
You two are both from Nevada. And, you know, I remember when I was at DOE, there were a couple of things that we made decisions on, where as a senior executive, I had felt that it would have been great to have been able to sit down and craft a decision that was a mutual negotiation with the state of Nevada, which we never were able to do that, you know, transportation routes. I know there's always a lot of talk about shipping waste through Las Vegas, but the Secretary of Energy made a commitment in 2002 that we would never ship waste through Las Vegas and the Strip and that kind of thing, but people tend to forget that when they're making an argument about, you know, fear-mongering experience.
Yeah, but the routes were in the EIS. So
all the routes considered were in the EIS.
That's right.
And we considered routes all over the country. But, you know, but the thing is, the point was not to get into that, but do you ever envision a situation where the federal government and the state of Nevada could sit down and come up with a negotiation where the state of Nevada had a seat at the table, where public health and safety, their voice was heard on all those issues, transportation, their voice was heard and meant something on all those issues, and if we as a country could work with Nevada to do this, do either of you envision
that? I'd be happy to, if we could agree to move forward with licensing, I'd be happy to take that to my board to say, yes, let the state, when it's done, if it's, of course, if it's not proven safe, we'll join them in saying no. But if it's proven to be safe, you know, let them have a chance to say no again. I don't have an issue with that, but I think we're missing the point. The state has twice gone to federal court to claim states' rights. This is a national security issue on a national security site. I just don't see it as a state rights issue. What other national security site allows local, tribal, and state governments to tell them no? And we have a couple in my county already, so I know that we didn't say anything. We're the only county that had 9 atomic bombs dropped on it. So,
that was why I was going to go ahead and
that's why we're here. It's a state rights issue.
Right.
And that's a big problem going forward. I'm not authorized to say if this legislation that Nevada's delegation has passed, that would change Nevada's position. We have a 7-member commission appointed by the governor. We also consult with the attorney general, and we consult with the legislative leadership. And that position right now is very firm in opposition. The technical case, if we're required to go through adjudication, we're going to go through the adjudication. And this is just a hypothetical in my thinking. Because of the peculiarities of the Yucca Mountain site, I mean, listen, those of you in the audience that know that this is, the best you can say about this is it's a complicated and complex environment for a repository. So these are not easy issues. And I wouldn't say it's an easy issue to do a salt site. I work on crystalline sites. I advise Texas on a salt site. So no geologic repository site is easy to license anywhere, anytime. The more you study it, the more you're going to find reasons to disqualify it rather than qualify it. But that said, we think the peculiar issues of unsaturated zone disposal in this particular environment in the Amargosa Valley really require the the kind of technical issue debate that we're going to, frankly, just my personal opinion, if I were advising DOE, and I've said this before, I would have advised DOE in 2010 to withdraw the license for the purpose of amending it, because it was already clear at that point in time that the utilities were using welded canister storage systems that we now think probably at least half of the first 63,000 MTUs of civilian spent fuel are completely incompatible with the package design in the license application. So it's not just people ripping each other to pieces for the purpose of ripping each other apart. There are real serious science and engineering issues involved in the site assessment and the repository design. And even if Nevada wanted the other them, which we do not, we would still want to go through that licensing proceeding, because whoever makes a decision to accept it then has got to answer to the public and, you know, be responsible for a 10,000 to 1 million year decision. So the licensing proceeding, if this goes forward, is going to be conducted in that way.
Okay. Chris, do you have another question?
Good morning. My name is Julie Herford from the Nevada's Citizen Action Network. We're not pro-Yucca Mountain per se. We like to see our state to reconsider a new yet common sense approach to Yucca Mountain issue. There's many questions after listening to both speakers, but time is short. I have one question to Mr. Housings. What would you qualify the state's right when the Yucca Mountain site is sitting on a public land? Our state has been fighting this 87% land owned by the government or BLM. So how would you argue a state right within
I get this. You'd ask me what would I qualify as state's rights. Well, the Constitution lays out certain powers for the federal government. Among those, national security. This is a national security issue. We have national security sites. A national security issue on federal land. And we have those, again, I host one in my county, where we've had atomic tests, and we bring in all sorts of low-level waste every day. That we don't have any say over. Mr. Halstead knows, and I think many people in this room know, that the president today could say, we're going to put nuclear spent fuel or nuclear waste, true waste, into Area 5 or at the test site, and there's nothing the state can do about it because it's national security on federal land. So that's how I see that. Yeah. And don't get me wrong, I've been classified as a far right-wing guy, and I believe in states' rights. I think the federal government overreach is being done. This is not a federal overreach. This is a moral and legal obligation the federal government took on years ago to take spent fuel, and I would really love to continue to say that. It's spent fuel that's going to go into Yucca Mountain, not waste. And that's where I really appreciated Mark Amity said, we don't really just want it done. Let's reprocess and recycle it. While it's not economically feasible now to do it, put some money into R&D, put some money into our colleges. Let's figure out how we can do it. What's the figure? 90% of uranium mines are owned by Russia now? What are we going to do in the future? Let's reprocess and recycle this stuff. So there are certain places that the federal government has power and has to do things. National security is one of them. This is a national security issue. I can't say that enough. So it's a national security issue.
Okay, we're getting the hood.
So, let me just say the law we're operating under creates a special relationship between the Department of Energy and the host state. And the host state is responsible under the law for really carrying out all of the oversight and licensing activities occur. I worry about deviation from that law and things like an effort to put a mineral storage facility on the NNSS. I think Rick Perry may have let a cat out of the bag, and I'm hoping that's not something that's a secret plan. It's been publicized this information. The law that Dan speaks so fondly of creates this situation where it's the state that's responsible for carrying these responsibilities in the licensing proceeding. And then there's a role for counties. And this would say the consent-based legislation that we support is designed to give the host county an equal seat at the table, which is something that does not exist now and might not exist at some future time. And so deciding to support that legislation is something serious consideration.
And Bob, I agree with you on the first part of that, not the last part, but the first part, the state should be working with the federal government to solve this, and so we should move forward and have all those contingents heard. And if it is not prudent, say, hey, I don't want all my grandchildren, my children live close to that place.
And we'll let that be the last word. Please join me in thanking all of you.